Good morning. Welcome. I am so grateful that you are here. I'm grateful to be here with you. Thanks so much for bringing the church into these rooms. Welcome to those of you online who are joining us around the world. Welcome to the correctional facilities that are with us. You are a part of this family, and we are glad for that. And we gather together every weekend for one purpose. It is to worship God for who He is and for what He has done. And we do that, one, because He is absolutely worthy of it. And the second reason is to recenter our hearts and our lives upon God Himself. All week long, we hear competing promises and stories of the good life, but we gather here to remember the one who has called us to His true promises, to His story. And this morning, we worship Christ because He has called us out of darkness, out of empty promises, but He calls us into His wonderful light, a light that includes an abundant life in God, a God who is sovereign and holy, but a God who is personal. So personal that He invites each of us to call Him Father. So personal that, in fact, in the middle of His word, He gives us a book of personal prayers, the Psalms. It's not just personal, though. It's not to be private. We're to pray those together as the family of God. And that's what we want to do this morning. That's going to begin our time as a call to worship. I'm going to pray this prayer from Psalm 86 on our behalf. And so would you stand? As we begin our time together, would you close your eyes and hear these words from Psalm 86? Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am godly. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all the day. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of why they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love. Dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
Just what we need before me.
Let's respond together with this response of prayer. Open our eyes, O God, our Father,
that we may behold what you have done for us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that we may see your infinite love that heals our hearts.
Open our ears, O God, our Father,
that we may hear your call upon our lives, a call that brings us joy, purpose, and mission as we do the good works you have prepared for us.
Open our minds, O God, our Father,
that we may know the treasures of wisdom and knowledge hidden in Christ and understand what it means to walk in your ways.
Open our hearts, O God, our Father,
that by your Spirit we may be flooded with the light of your glory revealed to us in the face of Christ, grasping the hope to which we've been called. Amen.
You may be seated for a moment. Well, for those of you who have been with us, you know we've been in this series called The Tipping Point. And Pastor Joel has been teaching us what it means to pray, what it means to give, and what it means to live. And there is a foundational question underneath those things, underneath praying, giving, and living. And that question is, what is your treasure? What is my treasure? What our treasure is has the power to either fracture and divide our hearts in such a way that it leads to worry and fear, that it leads to restlessness, or it has the power to unite our hearts, to make our hearts whole in such a way that it leads to joy and to peace. This is why Jesus taught us that where your treasure is, there your heart will be too. And it's why David in Psalm 86 writes those words, "O Lord, give me an undivided heart to fear you, to worship you, to treasure you." And that is the beginning of a whole heart. It is worship. It is treasuring God above all things. And that is what happens as a result of the power of the cross, what we just sang about. It frees us up to be freed from every lesser treasure in our lives, and it frees us to put God as our supreme treasure. And when that happens, our hearts are mended, our hearts are healed. God is making us whole. We become wholehearted people. Pastor and writer Chuck DeGroat talks about this in his book, Tough People to Love, and he says this about wholeheartedness. He says, wholeness can also be described as soulfulness, a life that's centered, passionately engaged, open, creative, connected, and propelled by a sense of mission. We've been learning about that. We've been learning that God has called us on a mission. We're on mission with God, individually, but also together as the church, as God's children. We are on that mission, and it begins and ends in worship. That's where wholeheartedness begins. The psalmist in Psalm 84 gives us a wonderful picture of what wholeheartedness looks like. This is what he writes. He says, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy for the living God."
How lovely is
Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are gathered in all of these places as your church, as your people, and as your children. And you gather us here by the power of your Spirit, by the good news of Jesus, for one purpose: to see your goodness and your mercy, to see your splendor and your glory, to see your holiness and your beauty. And as a result, it changes us. You, through your Spirit, heal our hearts. You make us wholehearted people that follow after you. That's what we want to be. We want the words that we just sung not to just be words, but to be the cry of our hearts together, that you are our one desire, and that we want to follow after you as you lead us as your people. And we join in with those in the heavenly courts who praise you and worship you, who know the joy it is to be in your presence. And we, as your children, encounter that joy even now as we are together. And so we pray that this morning you would continue to teach us your ways, that you would continue to call us deeper in to a relationship with you and one another, and that we would follow you in such a way that our very lives would be an act of worship to you, that our tithes and our offerings would be worship to you because you are worthy of it all. And so we pray now that you would continue to lead us in this time. And we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Let's pray this together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
That song that we just sang together just before our prayer comes directly out of Psalm 84. It may be familiar to you. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. And what's interesting about that passage, the very next verse tells us why, as if we didn't already know. It tells us that the Lord God is a sun and shield, and he bestows favor and honor. Just think about that for a moment. As we worship the Creator God, who knows all about us, who knows everything intricately about this world, he bestows honor on us, on his creation. It says, no good thing will he withhold from those whose walk is upright and those whose walk is blameless. Can you think of anyone or anything that is more worthy of our worship? That is why we here together gather to worship the one true God for who he is and for what he has done and for what he continues to do in our life, for who he continues to be in our life. It truly is a joy to not only worship with you today, but to journey with you as we come together and we bring the church into these rooms, both here in Longwood and those of you who are joining with us online abroad. We are so glad that you got up this morning and chose to worship with us. I want to give a special greeting, by the way, to those of you who are joining us from correctional facilities, our Seminole County Correctional Facility, the Tomoka, Correctional Institute, and the Polk County Correctional Institute. Welcome to you. We're so glad you joined us today. I want to mention to you as well, you probably aren't aware of this, but many of us are. We get a weekly e-blast, a weekly email of things that are happening around Northland. I know many of you receive that. You guys in the correctional facilities are some of our featured stories this week, the men and women who are taking steps of faith. You may have already seen the video clip in there this week. We are so inspired by you. We pray for you. We pray with you. Thank you for being the church, and thank you for being the distributed church where you are. We're with you and we celebrate you. So glad that you chose to worship with us again today. If you walked in the doors here at Longwood today, hopefully you received a worship guide. Great point of communication both ways for us every week. It's a great opportunity, if it's your first time today, to communicate that with us. We love to know that it's your first time at Northland. We always love to try to connect and encourage you in this new journey with us. You may have a specific prayer need. You may have an interest in getting connected or taking a new step in your faith. There's a little form in the back that will give you an opportunity to communicate that to us. It also gives us an opportunity to communicate with you. In fact, you'll see numerous announcements in there each week of opportunities to get connected. This week, actually, you'll also notice that there's a card in there, a little different from normal. This card is a commitment card. If you haven't been with us over the last few weeks, welcome back. We were in a great series here called Tipping Point. Far more than a series, this is a tipping point moment in our church where we are watching and experiencing together what God has for us in the years to come. Pastor Joel will continue that series today. But the commitment card is something that we're putting in there. He'll give you more information about it in his message in a few minutes. Looking forward to that next week, a major commitment Sunday in the journey of our church. So hang on to that, you'll get more information later. I'd like to highlight just two opportunities, though, that appear in the worship guide this week that are coming up this week that we want to make sure that you're aware of, good opportunities to get connected. The first one is this. In reference to the tipping point, you've been hearing that there have been over 60 new churches form in Central Florida, distributed churches, personal church, whatever label we put on it. It's these spiritual families that are gathering, all new, all over Central Florida, over 60 of them. And many of you, even in this room, and some of you may be watching online, have participated and are engaged in that. Some of you are engaged in something else, maybe a small group or a Bible study or some kind of a gathering. And you may be asking yourself the question, where does that, my Bible study or my small group, where does that fit in the vision that God is giving to Northland? That's a great question. You may wonder if it even fits in it. Well, we want to get together with you because this Thursday night we have a small group leadership summit where not only do we believe that you fit into the vision, it is vital to the vision of what you're experiencing together. And we want to talk more about that and connect you with others who are on the journey as well. So you'll see more information in the worship guide. It's also available online this Thursday night, 6 o'clock here at the Longwood campus. So do us the favor and either register online, you can click on the homepage and do that, or right after the service you can stop by in the hub along with Rebecca Lang, Marty Tracy will be in there to answer any questions and help you know more about what's happening Thursday night. If you're a small group leader, a Bible study leader, or you're even interested, you've wondered about connecting in one or even starting one, this is definitely for you. Great place to learn more and have more conversations with others who are on that journey, okay? This Thursday night right here at Longwood. The other big event that's taking place is Friday night. We have our Family Fall Festival this Friday night right here at the Longwood campus. If you've been around over the last few years, you know this, that this is one of those highlights of the year where it doesn't matter your age or it doesn't matter where you're at, this is for anybody to come and have a great night. There's pony rides for the kids, there's petting zoos, carnival things, great time, bounce houses, great time planned again this Friday night. You'll need tickets for the event, so you can also get those online, or you can actually stop by the bookstore if you're here at the Longwood campus, and you can get tickets for that this Friday night. Any other questions or any other information you would need on that or prayer needs, we always love the opportunity to serve you. Right after the service, you can stop by the hub. I'll be back there, several of us. We'd love the opportunity to meet you over there. Speaking of which, if you happen to go by the hub, there's a good chance you may see our good friends, Lon and Val Garber. They're our distributed pastor to Namibia. Some of you know who they are, yeah? I hope they can hear you applauding for them. Had some great conversations with them earlier. Lon serves as a pastor and leader to and mentor to many pastors and leaders in Namibia, Southern Africa, where they are forming a distributed training center. And then his wife, Val, she helps with made by our hands, crafted by our hands. The ladies there in Namibia are making these handmade, beautiful pieces of jewelry. You might have seen the display out here that is available for purchase this weekend. All proceeds go to help these families and these ladies who are in Namibia. And so I hope you encourage, just stop by, say hi to them. If you say hi, you need to say this, Wala Lepo. Say Wala Lepo to Lon and Val. And they know that what you're saying to them is good morning in a Namibian tongue. Wala Lepo, you want to try that with me? Wala Lepo? Wala Lepo. In fact, in just a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to say that to each other as we greet each other this morning. Have no idea exactly how to spell that, but online you can try to type that to each other. So why don't we practice, stand, say Wala Lepo to each other, greet each other this morning, and then Pastor Joel will bring this morning's message.
This is quickly becoming the church where you learn a new African word every week. It's good for us. I'm not sure how to say in any African dialect, let us pray, but let us pray. Lord, reveal yourself to us this morning. Teach us through your word. Apply it to our minds that we might not grow shallow. And apply it to our hearts that we might not grow cold. And apply it to our feet that we might be doers of the word and not hearers only. Amen. I'm glad you came this morning because I'm going to talk about you. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking about you. And I want you to hear this message so personally that you want to hear more about you from God. Do you remember, those of you who were here, what I began telling you at the very first service of this year, 2015? I said, God wants this to be the very best year you've ever lived in your life. I'm confident of that. Now watch. And I said, regardless of the circumstances. That's not just a disclaimer. There is a happiness and a joy and a fulfillment and a satisfaction that's deeper than any of your circumstances. We actually have proof of that. I don't know how many of you know the name Dan Gilbert. Dan is the professor of psychology at Harvard, and he's kind of the resident expert on happiness in the nation. And he's done all of these surveys, mounting evidence as to what makes people happy and what makes people unhappy. And most people miscalculate. They think that some sort of event can make them happy, or some sort of event can make them unhappy. They've done studies, for example, comparing those who won the lottery, you know, $350 million, and those who were in an accident that made them paraplegic. 1 year later, after both of those events happened, their level of happiness was about the same. And then through different studies, they have said, they've come up with this theory that call it an impact bias. We think that if this happens to us, good or bad, it will have much more of an impact than it really does. If I get married, I'll be happy. If I lose a relationship, I'll be destroyed. If so-and-so is elected, I'll be happy. If so-and-so is not elected, I'll be destroyed. And a year later, life's pretty much the same. And so happiness, joy, fulfillment is not about the circumstances. We just said and sang out of the song that says, oh, I just lost the words. Nothing I desire compares with you. Nothing I desire compares with you. So what does God want you to have? God wants you to have such a knowledge of his purpose. No, such an experience of his purpose. Because in the Bible, knowledge is not about cognition. It's not about information. Knowledge is about experience. Who we are, how we live. He wants you to have such an experience of his purpose for your life that you have this deep sense of, now I know why I was made like I was. Now I know why I've been through what I have. Now I know what is my gift that God is trying to give to the world through me. And so we said, the way you do this is you follow Christ. That's called a disciple. You grow in your discipleship. That is, you grow in your capability and your commitment in following Christ. And you assemble disciples together, and you have what Christ envisioned as a church. On you I will build my church, he said to his disciples. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. There's hell busting loose all over this world. There's hell busting loose in your lives every day. But this fellowship, this life-giving community that God wants you to have in a personal way is what will bring you to the point where you have what the world can't have. You have a peace that is beyond understanding. You have a joy that's deeper than anything the world can give you or take away. I'm talking to you. Each of us, fearfully and wonderfully made for a purpose, which God prepared beforehand. So let me tell you, just out of the book of Ephesians. You know, the book of Ephesians has been called the book of spiritual maturity. It talks about going on to maturity. And the first part of Ephesians talk about what God did for us. Talk about who we are because of the cross of Christ. It talks about God's grace that saves us. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. We are saved by grace. That's a gift. Saved by grace through faith. That is the gift of God, not through works, lest any man should boast. For you were created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that you should walk in them. And then the second part of Ephesians talks about the walk, because that's how you make progress, the walk. And so let me just start off with chapter 4, where it's talking about the walk. It says this in Ephesians chapter 4, therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. Two things I want you to notice there. Walk. How do you walk? Just take the next step. This isn't complicated. You just take the next step. I'm going to tell you just a little bit about this tipping point we're in right. This is just to get us to take the next step. That's all this is. Now, what that implies is don't stay where you are. Don't stay where you are. C.S. Lewis once said, being a Christian is kind of like being an egg. You either rot or you hatch. Okay? You can't stay where you are. The world moves on. Things change. Relationships change. They either get better or they get worse, but they never stay like they are. And so you've got to figure out, how can I take the next step? Walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. Every one of us is called. Called of God. Every one of us. Now watch what it says. When it talks about you, it's not just talking about you as an individual. The you here is plural. And so this is what Scripture is saying. I want each of you in the community which I gave you, that is the relationships that you have, I want each of you to make progress, and I want you all to make progress together. How does a group, how does our church that has a role that no other church in this world can fulfill? We have a calling on our church that no other church in this world can fulfill. It's absolutely unique. How do we make progress as a church? We all take the next step together. And so that's why verses 2 and 3 are all about the qualities that will help us be a part of a group. It goes on to say, with all humility, that's part of what you need to maintain and improve a relationship, and gentleness and patience and showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So what is God telling us to do? Saying, I want you to make progress. I want you, first of all, to understand that each of you have been called for a special purpose that cannot be done by anybody else but you. That's how sovereign and detailed our God is. And that's how much purpose and meaning each of our lives have. Nobody can do our part that God designed us for. We are called. It says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, this is what it says. It talks about Christ, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling. Now stop right there. Most people, when they become Christians, have all their eggs in one basket, and that's called salvation. And we just want people to get saved, you know, so they can go to heaven. Nothing wrong with that. But that's not the Bible's only concern. Saved us and called us. Our calling is of equal importance in Scripture. You have a holy calling. Please don't buy into the whole hierarchical church. Well, if you're a clergy person, if you're a minister that has been ordained, your calling is holier than everybody else's. No, it's not. It's just a different function. Your calling in your relationships is just as holy as my calling in my relationships. This isn't written to clergy. This is written to followers of Christ. Called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was granted us in Jesus, in Christ Jesus, from all eternity. There it is again. He planned on you. He planned on how you're wired. He planned on where you are right now. You're not a surprise to Him. And you have a powerful ministry where you are right now. But it won't be powerful if you stay where you are right now. You have to take the next step. Each of us has to take the next step. And it's way more powerful when we take the next step together. That's why Paul would write in Philippians chapter 3, verse 14, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Could I ask you a question? Do you know what your prize is? See, most of us have no idea what our that there's a prize out there waiting on us. You know? That there's a blessing that God has stored up. I'm going to teach you about that in just a minute. Most of us don't realize at what cost our inaction comes to us. You understand, the judgment doesn't just happen at the end of time. It happens every day. And you understand the picture that is given to us in Matthew 25 of the judgment. There's only one person who Jesus is really kind of ticked with. And this is what it says. There was a person who got a talent and he buried it. And Jesus said, what are you doing? Why'd you do that? Why didn't you use what I gave you? And in Matthew 25, verse 25, it says this, well, I was afraid. I was afraid. And I went away and I hid your talent in the ground. See, you have what is yours. See, I'm just giving it back to you. But his master answered and said to him, you wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I do not sow, and I gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money at least in the bank, and on arrival I would have received my money back at least with some interest, invested in something. See, we can't just keep what God's given us because we face a judgment. Do you know that judgment comes every day? When we're too afraid to use what God has given us for the benefit and the investment in other people? You know it comes every day? We live in fear instead of in fulfillment and satisfaction, entering into the joy of our master. It's really important for us to understand we have a really faulty theology if we think God only enters into our lives periodically. You know, that's basically our prayer life. God, I want you to come and do this for me. You know, God, I want you to come into my life and act at such and such a way. And so we have this God who only intervenes at certain points. That's not what Scripture says. Scripture says God walks with us every day. We just don't see it because we're waiting on these big events that will make us happy, these big events that will make us safe. And that's why our prayers are so stunted, because they're so limited. Instead of praying for God to do stuff, we ought to pray that God would open our eyes to the stuff He's doing all around us. That our every day would come to a point where if something big does come along, we have walked and practiced with God every day. We have done our responsibility to Him every day. Do you understand, don't you, that David was really good with a sling before he ever met Goliath? Everybody understands that? That's what a shepherd did. He took those stones. Every day, David had a sling and a stone in his hand. And when something attacked his sheep, it was not any better off. So that when Goliath came, he was ready. Do you understand? Every day, God is working through your life. Every day, with every relationship. C.S. Lewis once said, you know, we think of miracles as these grand interventions of something strange that God has done in our life. But really, a miracle is just a local event that you can recognize of a general principle God does all the time. You think it was a miracle that God, that Jesus turned water into wine at the wedding feast? Well, of course it was. But you understand, don't you? God does that every day. The water enters into the roots of the vine in the vineyard. And the water travels up and gives life and growth to the grape. And the grape, when it's harvested, eventually turns into wine. God turns water into wine every day, but we don't recognize it because it's so normal. You think it was a miracle when Jesus healed people? Of course it was. And every once in a while, He does that. He still does it. But do you understand? You're here today because God has healed you every day. Otherwise, you'd be dead. There are a thousand bacteria, viruses that are attacking you all the time. And God is healing you every day. So what should we look for? We should look for God to be working through us in our normal relationships every day, and that's how he creates the miracle of the transformation of our lives and this world. Friday morning, I was at a sheriff's prayer breakfast. We have this annually where the sheriffs and the ministers get together and we have a prayer breakfast, and so it's wonderful. We have such a great relationship with the law enforcement in this community. I mean, it's just absolutely wonderful. We're in this together. We are in this together. Both the city and county officials and the law enforcement and the churches and the you know, all of the religious community. We're so in this together. I love this. But we have this prayer breakfast every year. And this year the guest speaker was this officer who had gotten shot at point blank range with a shotgun in his stomach as he was trying to protect this car dealership under attack from a gunman. And he was able to take the gunman out, but at this huge hole, and there was a 3% chance that he would live. 3%. And God spared his life. And when they called him up, and when we saw the video on this guy, you could see that he would be impacted for the rest of his life. He's had a stroke. He has a limp. And he got up, and he wasn't much of a speaker. And he didn't claim to be. He mostly just got teary-eyed, and he thanked God that he was still alive. And he thanked God for his wife and his two little girls that were sitting in the front table. He thanked God that he had more time with them. And he said, "I don't know what people do without faith, but I know I couldn't do what I do without my faith." And then he just said, "Thank you," and he limped back to his chair, and that was it. It was one of the most touching talks I'd ever seen, because it wasn't graphic and spectacular. It was just a man thanking God for what he had. And in him I saw you. Because every day you lay down your life for others. Maybe it's not spectacular. Maybe it doesn't get awards, but you lay it down for your family and you lay it down for your friends. And so many of you have been wounded because you have loved. And you know that's what love costs. But you wouldn't have had it any other way. And many of you will walk with a limp for the rest of your life. And God wants you to know that he loves you and appreciates you because you're doing what Jesus did. You're laying down your life for others who may or may not appreciate it. So I want us to understand that this tipping point that we're at for our lives and for our church isn't about some spectacular event. It's about finally understanding what God's going to do with prayer and finally understanding how God operates. When we pray, what happens? Well, it says in Isaiah chapter 46, verses 3 and 4, "Listen to me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel," that'd be us, "you who have been born by me from birth and have been carried from the womb," is my favorite part, "even to your old age, I will be the same. And even to your graying years, I will bear you. I have done it. I will carry you. I will bear you, and I will deliver you. God is saying that. I'm there for you every day of your life, and I want you to know it. And I want you to recognize it. I want you to feel my presence. And I want you to understand that I'm guiding your steps. You can make your plans. I'm guiding your steps. I want you to open your eyes. You think you're surrounded. You think you're in a tight spot. I understand. And every time I say this, I think back to one of my favorite scriptures in all the Bible, in Elisha. Remember this story in Elisha where Elisha is in a tent with his servant, and his servant wakes up early in the morning and goes outside the tent and sees all of the enemy has surrounded them in the middle of the night. And he just wants to pass out. He just absolutely wants to, you know, it's just like, oh, no. And so he goes into Elisha and he wakes him up. He says, I want you to come out and see it. And Elisha comes out, and you can just picture this. Elisha looks all around and just starts grinning. And the servant looks at him and says, why are you grinning? Why are you smiling? And Elisha prays this. I love this. 1 Kings 6:17. Then Elisha prayed and said, O Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the servant, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Now let me translate that for you. Yes, they were surrounded by the enemy. Yes, you are facing difficult circumstances. But guess who the enemy is surrounded by? The heavenly host. Your enemy is the one that is surrounded. You understand? God's going to get you through this. You need to understand that. Open your eyes and see what God has given you. This is what it says in Isaiah 65. It will also come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. In other words, God doesn't wait for us to pray. God's already on the move. It's not we pray so we can see God act in the future. It's we pray so we can see what God's doing all around us and what he's given us in order to accomplish the mission he's given us. Because when we begin to understand that, we'll begin to understand that when he planned us, when he planned us, when he planned each of us, he planned a certain amount of blessings that as we walked, as we took the next step, we would begin to receive, we would begin to realize. It says in Psalm 31:19, how abundant are the good things that you have stored up. Say that with me. Stored up. Say that word. Stored up. You have blessings stored up just for you. For those who reverence you, fear you, that you bestow in the sight of all on those who take refuge in you. As you believe, as you walk, you begin to realize those. So, how do we take the next step? Well, first of all, it's got to be something you do. It's not just, it can't be something you do up here. That's why that prayer says, apply it to our feet, that we might be doers of the word and not hearers only. And so that's why we're doing this. It's just something we can do in a concrete way. I want you to take out this brochure just for a second. And we're going to turn these in next week, and it's going to be a celebration. It's going to be a party next week. It's going to be a lot of fun, because you celebrate when people are taking the next step together. I don't need to explain. It's so simple. I don't need to explain all this to you, but let me tell you why it's so specific. Because unless our next step is a concrete commitment, we probably won't take it. We need something practical. We're action-oriented people. We're physical people. And that's why next week, physically, we're going to be moving down here and we're going to be putting these in baskets. We're physical people. And so we need to take concrete steps to know I'm taking my next step with God, not only in my giving, but in my living. And not to leave the students out, because the students are also free moral agents. They are people. And we want them to take responsibility just as every adult is taking responsibility. So this is for the students, the green one. Ages are grades 1 through 12, and we want to challenge them. Pray. Do what God says. It's that simple. Lord, what should I do? I will use this to help me pray. Just help me check a box, all right? And help me to put down my information so that it's me, and I'm making a commitment. And it's practical, and it's concrete, and it's identifiable, and it's more than just something I have purposed in my heart. It's a commitment to the community that I belong to. You remember the original verse, that you are called to a calling, each of us in the group we are in. So that's what we're going to do next week. And I want to challenge every one of you. Or if it's a man and a wife and you do your giving together, then you feel... Now, let me say this. The church has so much bad baggage. And every time we mention money or action, recruitment of any sort, it's like, oh, here we go again, talking about money. Yeah, I knew they'd get around to it. You need to understand this. The church is in great financial shape. This is not about money. But there's no way we can fully commit ourselves without a financial aspect to it. There isn't, because that's why we live. That's what we talk about. That's how we think. And so this is about our heart. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. That's what Jesus taught us. So this is about our heart. Having said that, some of you are in excruciating places right now. You're not getting any money. Those of you in incarceration, you know, you haven't got any money coming in. So you go, what can I do with this? Pray. Do whatever God says. It's that simple. Some of you, I mentioned before the suffering that we go through. Some of you are in such a difficult time of life right now. You're just one big ball of pain. As a matter of fact, it's very hard for you to listen to anything I have to say. Because you want to, but everything I say reminds you of something else that hurts. And so you just keep going back to the... Listen, we don't do guilt here. We don't do pressure. We don't do anything. We're not trying to artificially make you do something for the institution of the church. But the reason this is important for every one of us is if you're in a place of pain, if you're in a place of poverty, you will stay there until you take a next step. You understand? This is about taking the next step to overcome the poverty you were in, to overcome the pain you were in. Somebody has said, if you're in hell, if you're walking through hell, don't stop. Because you'll just be stuck there. And we don't want people stuck in hell. We don't want people stuck in pain. We don't want people stuck in poverty. We don't want people stuck in unbelief. We want all of us responding to God, say, God, what's my next step? Lead me, I'll follow. That's why we're doing this. And then ultimately, we need to understand, even though as we walk into the future together, and this is going to take a while, but as we walk into the future together and you begin to realize how important you are for the mission God has for the entire world, how important it is that you gather around people who can speak into your life and pull out stuff you had no idea was there. As we form these personal churches, as you begin to realize all of this, here's what I hope all of us ultimately realize. Two things: how God acts and how important it is for us to glorify Him and Him alone. Here's how God acts. For all of us waiting for God to swoop down and be the star of the show, there are times when He does that, but that's not how He usually acts. I was listening to a tape the other day, one of my old sermons, and it had a reference. This is 25 years ago, to this Christian school that asked both Vernon and I to come out and do a devotional time. And it's very unusual, you know, even back then for us to both go together, you know, but apparently there was a reason for us to be there together. And so one of the things they wanted Pastor Vernon to do is to teach them to sing parts of Psalm 139. Search me and try me, O God, and know my heart. You've heard him sing that, right? It's gorgeous. When he sings that, I just want to melt. I just want to go, oh, that's all I need, oh. And so he's teaching his school kids to sing. And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking to myself, Vernon, you've got this astounding voice. Sing out. I want them to hear your voice. I want to belt it out, Vernon. Come on. I need to hear your voice. Just belt it out. But he stayed underneath their voices the entire time. And I finally realized he was there for them. He wasn't there for him. He wasn't there to be the star of the show. He wasn't there to do a solo. God isn't here to do solos. The reason we don't see him more explicitly is because he's staying under us. He's lifting our voices. He's put in us gifts to distribute to the world. That's how he acts. That's who the Holy Spirit is. So many times, to hear him at all, you're going to have to listen really hard. You're going to have to notice more than ordinary, because God's not here to do a solo. And the second thing I want all of us to understand is this: that when it comes right down to it, for an eternity, our greatest moments will be spent in simply giving God the glory for anything he does. I know I keep saying this is about us realizing our purpose, but it's really about us realizing our purpose giver and telling him how important that is to us. Years ago, my stepfather, who, bless his heart, there was nothing extraordinary about this man. I love this man. But most of you know that my father died when I was 4 years old. He was dashing and brave and someone everybody loved, great deal of charisma. And some years later, my mom just married this ordinary guy. Everything about him was ordinary. He'd lived with his mother and a cat until he was 40 years old. Just kind of lived that kind of life, you know? Totally dependable. He was a good Catholic man, but would never talk. Back in those days, you didn't talk about religion. Catholics and Protestants didn't, you know? And so here he is. He's so weak. He's had strokes. He's in a nursing home. And I flew up to visit him, and I knew I wouldn't be there very long, and then probably this would be the last time I got to talk to him. When he understood what I was saying, he understood everything that was going on, but his strokes limited him to one word. He could only say right. It was the only word he could say. So I sat there and I labored for a conversation that he could respond to with that word. And I said stuff like, Dad, do you remember the trips we used to take to Michigan? Will you let me drive the boat? Right. Remember how when you talk, we caught the fish, we take them into those old fish cleaning houses where they had, you know, ripped screens and they're just, you know, plank with a hole in it and you just put the fish guts down there in a bucket and the flies were all around. It was horrible. Right. I never thanked you. Remember when you'd go into work every day? My dad had one of the worst jobs. He made carbon paper. Some of you young people don't know what carbon paper is. It's how we used to make copies. It was called carbon paper. And at the Shelby Business Forums, that's what he did. And he would come home every night covered in this stuff. He'd have to boil his clothes every night. And every day he'd go into the factory just to put food on the table. And I said, Dad, do you remember when you'd go to work every day? And I used to think, how can he do that? How can he do that? But I want to tell you something. That's how I go to work every day now. I go in and I do my very best with whatever's there. And I learned that from you. And he said, right? And I said, Dad, I used to get up every once in a while of the night and I'd notice you were ready to go to work and you were having your breakfast and you had your rosary out and you were praying your beads. And we never got to talk about faith. Because in that day, Catholics didn't talk with Protestants and Protestants didn't talk with Catholics. We didn't have a Pope Francis. We just had a giant chasm. My dad never stepped foot into one of the churches that I was pastoring. He couldn't because he was old school. But I said, Dad, I never got to tell you the impact it had on me to see you praying every morning and the impact it's having on others because I saw you pray every morning. And by this time, the tears were starting to come. And he just said, right? Do you know what we need to do with our Heavenly Father? We need to tell Him every day we live what His gifts have meant to us and how we're using them to make this world different and to help people come to love Him and to know Him. And so right now, I'm going to pray for our prayers this week, all right? I'm going to turn around because my old style when I was a Methodist preacher is that you turn around and you face the altar and you led the congregation, being one of the congregation, praying to the Father. So I'm going to kneel down. I want the worship team to come out. I'm going to kneel down and I'm just going to pray briefly that God will let us hear from Him, each of us, no matter where you are, each of us. Let us hear from Him this week so that we can take the next step. Please pray with me. Father, we come because we love You and we love You because You have first loved us. You had a plan for each one of our lives. And we know that You still have a plan for each one of our lives. And so this is what we ask. as we pray to you this week, and we say, Lord, give me an inkling of what I could do next. Give me an inkling of my next step of giving and my next step of living. And I pray not only for myself, but for all of my church family. We pray, Lord, that you will let us know what you personally want us to do by that inkling. And ultimately, Lord, we pray that all through this process, you will build our faith, because we want everything we do to be a part of following you.
Let's continue to make this our prayer. Would you please stand?
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me
Fill one of these out online. You can do it online so that we can take the next step together. As you go out this week, remember at the Hub, Lon and Val Garber are there. Lon, by the way, was the chairman of the elders who called me here to preach. So I have a special affinity for this guy. But to have these African women that are deep in poverty pulling themselves into the grace of the talents God has given them so that they can produce something of beauty into the world and support their families at the same time. Think Christmas, buy something. Let me see, I'm reading the back wall here. You know everything you need to know. Let's go from this place. Loving Jesus and loving others like Jesus loves them, and watch what God does. Amen.